know what is going on. It's easy to come in and fill a pulpit when you're a stranger, because then everybody says, gosh, you get it wrong, it's better. But when you get it wrong and you're here every Sunday, boy, that's embarrassing. Listen for the Word of God. This will be Hebrews 13:2. Be sure to welcome strangers into your home. By doing this, some people have welcomed angels as guests without even knowing it. And then Matthew 25:35-45. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. And I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. And then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. And then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. And I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to drink. And I was a stranger, and you didn't welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick and in prison and didn't take care of you? And then you will answer, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Taking a page out of Pastor Little's new work on my iPad. Oswald Walter was a missionary in northern China during the 1940s, and after 10 long years of service, he was finally returning home. And his ship stopped in India, and while waiting for the boat home, he happened upon a group of refugees. And they were living in this warehouse in Ankhir, and they were unwanted by anyone else. These refugees were basically just stranded there. So Walter went to visit them, and since it was Christmas time, Walter wished them a Merry Christmas and asked what kind of gift they would like. Well, we're not Christians, they said. We don't believe in Christmas. I know, said the missionary, but what do you want for Christmas? And after thinking about it for a moment, they started describing these wonderful German pastries that they had and talked about how delicious they were. And so Walter cashed in his ticket, and he went to the bakery, and he bought baskets and baskets of these pastries. And he took them to the refugees, and he wished them a Merry Christmas. And later, when he was telling the story to a class, he said, why would you do this? Why would you give them a Christmas present? They don't even And I wish I had this great, wonderful story to tell, but I don't. The truth is that it's really quite simple. As a person of faith, as people of faith, we are called to reach out to others in need. And more than that, we are called to respond to that need. Our very name, Cross Ministries, the program that I direct, is an acronym. It is an acronym that speaks to that very thing. Christians reaching out, seeking to serve. We are people called to respond, not because of what others believe, but because of what we believe. And since the earliest of times, the religious community has served as an instrument of God's care, serving as God's hands, freely giving to the poor, caring for widows, and caring for the dying, visiting the sick and the imprisoned, taking in destitute orphans. The church is called not only to tend to the spiritual needs, but also the mental, emotional, and even physical health and well-being. The pastoral care and counseling programs help people who are seeking emotional healing. And our own pastor's wife, Rebecca, is a good example of someone who is offering a ministry through her faith-based counseling program. But food pantries, parish nurses, immunization clinics, homeless shelters, and an array of outreach resources enhance the wellness of people in the churches as well as in the greater community. I know that here in Johnston, when they needed a temporary home for the food pantry, this church, St. Paul Presbyterian, opened its doors to provide the space for that compassionate response. And the church is also an instrument of God's will for justice and shalom when it calls for systemic changes in our treatment of all who are marginalized, responding to Christ's call to the least of these. Christ Ministries was founded by the now-dissolved Cottage Grove Presbyterian Church in partnership with the Presbytery of Des Moines as the Presbytery's compassionate response to people in crisis. And when Cross opened its doors 40 years ago, the need existed most urgently in the inner city of Des Moines. But over time, that need expanded. And today, Cross works to address hunger and homelessness throughout all of Polk County and advocates for the greater good of all islands. Our mission statement reads, Cross seeks to serve people in need through assistance and counsel, works to correct systems which produce or perpetuate poverty and oppression, and envisions and advocates for justice. Cross assists men, women, and children that include the underemployed single mother struggling to make ends meet in a challenging economy, the disabled person living on Social Security benefits that barely covers their rent, leaving nothing left to deal with an emergency need, people who are experiencing mental illness, the newly returned veterans, as well as those whose wars raged long ago but linger in their hearts and minds, the refugees and immigrants trying to find their way in a new world, and people who have recently lost their employment or experienced dramatically reduced work hours, and the families of young children who are facing evictions or the loss of their utility services. The other day, while flipping through community is to work with whomever Jesus drags through those doors. All are welcome in this place. And it occurred to me that that statement was true for Cross Ministries as well. All are welcome here. The family surge through Cross arrived in my office from all different life circumstances. Many that I work with are experiencing disabling physical health problems and have not yet been approved for disability financial assistance through our backlogged government programs. And some deal with chronic mental illness or addictions. And some come from a culture of poverty, while still others are just chronic poor or struggling simply due to bad circumstances. And many are living paycheck to paycheck, barely making ends meet. Perhaps a car breaks down or the child gets sick. And at best, it's the loss of day's wages. And at worst, the loss of a job. And for a household living at the poverty line, child care or any small financial crisis can break a family's budget. My such family that I worked with recently and assisted was a single mother named Alyssa, who also had a little boy named Matthew, who was 8 years old. Now, Alyssa had been working for a local coffee shop. She'd been a manager of a neighborhood coffee shop for the last several years. But she found a better job, and it was with a restaurant chain, and it was actually going to offer her $500 a month more. That's huge. And for a mother and child who were struggling, you know, barely making ends meet, living paycheck to paycheck, that's pretty exciting. They were very grateful for that opportunity. So Alyssa gave her 2-week notice. And then, as bad luck would have it, on the next to the last day, right before she was to leave, she fell on the job, injuring both her knee and her shoulder. Now, Alyssa's workplace covered the medical bills for this fall, but they refused to pay any temporary disability because they said she'd already given her notice. The new place of employment said they would hold the job for her, but of course she wouldn't have any income because she wouldn't be working and hadn't started that job yet. So during her 8 weeks of recovery, followed by the 2 weeks on, you know, the new job while she was waiting for that first paycheck to come in, the mother and child would be living without any income. So they didn't have any funds to pay even the most basic of living expenses. Well, for those of us in the middle class, it's really easy to think, well, surely there's a family member that could step up, you know, and help them out. But that's not always the case. And, you know, really the simple answer for this woman and for the majority of the clients that we see, since there isn't anyone else that can help that family member, there isn't anyone else with sufficient resources to be able to help. So if not for Cross Ministries, a hardworking mother and her child would have lost their apartment just when their life was supposed to be getting a little easier. But Cross Ministries was there, serving as this presbytery's compassionate response to a family in crisis. Cross was able to help Alyssa and her son in both physical and spiritual ways. Now, first, we were able to help with the most critical need, which that's, you know, of course, housing. And that was huge for them. But in addition, we were able to help the family with things like personal hygiene items and items that this congregation and others have collected and provided for us to give out. And those gifts not only help to stretch their budget, but it helps to lift their spirits. We all know how much better we feel when we're able to bathe, shampoo for our hair, brush our teeth, put on clean clothes. We've all heard it said that cleanliness is next to godliness. In addition to the personal hygiene items, we were able to help with food from our food pantry. But in addition to physical needs, many of our families come to us despondent. And they are fearful for the future. And as a therapist, I am pleased that I'm not required to push through one family after another like an assembly line, but can take the time to hear that family's story and to convey the sense that each one, in fact, is cared for as a child of God. That knowledge that others care inspires a sense of hope and strength for them to continue on. And although we have no religious requirements for receiving assistance, the fact that all of this takes place in a church conveys the idea that it is God's church that is helping them. Another factor that added to the growing need in the greater Des Moines community is the steady increase in clients that are refugees and immigrants. And walking through our doors every day of the week are people from Southeast Asia, Bosnia, Sudan, Burma, Ethiopia, and too many other countries to even list. And they're struggling just as our own ancestors did. We know that some will succeed, while others may continue to struggle indefinitely, but the dream is there. The hopes for their children and for a peaceful life in a safer, saner world. And one such household that fled their troubled homeland to start a new life in Des Moines was a husband, wife, and their two children who needed a small amount of financial help to pay a portion of their month's rent. Mubarak and his wife, Fatima, came to Iowa after escaping war-torn North Sudan. And both husband and wife are very intelligent people. In fact, living in a time and place where few women were educated, Fatima had actually managed to go to school and had been a medical worker in the refugee camp, helping victims of war. But Mubarak had dreams of becoming an aerospace engineer, and he'd even been accepted to the university, which he said made his mother very, very proud. But sadly, right before he was to begin his studies, he was captured and imprisoned by the rebel forces. And with the help of friends, the two were able to escape and flee to the United States. Here, Fatima's academic studies weren't recognized. So instead, she ended up cleaning bathrooms and floors in an office building. But Mubarak had made his wife a promise, and that promise was that she could return to school and study medicine once again. And so when the family came to me, his wife had just finished school, or was finishing school, was about to quit her housekeeping job and to begin a new paid internship in her field. The problem was that Mubarak, who had been working at a local factory for the last few years and was the family's primary source of income, had been laid off during a shutdown a few months prior. They soon found out that they were not eligible for Polk County General Assistance, and they had nowhere else to turn except for Cross Ministries. The team's minimum wage job, cleaning job, was not sufficient to pay for their apartment rent. Mubarak explained that he was going to be returning to work the next month, and they simply needed just that little bit of help to get over the rough patch. If they didn't receive that help, needed was just that little bit of help to move them beyond their current struggles. They had achieved so much. They just had to deal with this temporary setback and what was otherwise going to become a bright future. The sad fact, though, is that not all of the people that we help are headed for a bright future. Some are caught up in a cycle of poverty where they live in constant jeopardy of not making ends meet. They receive food stamps or PIP and other lifelines that barely manage to keep their heads out of water. And because we do not simply want to give people a handout but a hand up, we routinely partner with other churches and organizations to try to find ways not just to help these families survive another day, another week, but also to get them the training and resources that they need to maybe move out of that grinding cycle of poverty. The annual back-to-school giveaway that we hold each year for 1,500 children from low and low-income families, providing them with a new backpack filled with the great appropriate school supplies, is just one of the many ways in which we help people get out of that cycle of poverty through education. No child should ever have to start school late or begin without the supplies that other children have. No child should ever be made to feel ashamed. An investment in the children is an investment in the future for all of us as a society. But the needs in the communities are growing and our funds are limited. And every day when we open our doors, there are 10 to 15 families or more waiting to see if Cross Ministries can help them through a housing crisis or other emergency need. And with a level of need and desperation that high, it's not uncommon for people to line up outside our church doors hours before we open. The problems facing the poor are great. The need is great. But God is even greater. So the good news is that by working together, doing what we are called to do as people of faith, not because of what others believe, but because of what we believe, we continue to be instruments of God's shalom. All are welcome.